Okay, so we're going to look at something different now. We're going to look at what we call unsupervised learning. So we've mentioned PCA a couple of times with PCR and sort of in the some of the data exploration, but let's actually go and have a good look at it. So this belongs in what we call unsupervised learning. So what do we mean by unsupervised learning? Well, so far every time we've had a load of predictors. So we've got p predictors, we denote x1, x2 up to xp, and we have a response variable y. And what we're trying to do is we try to say, can we predict y using the predictors? Or can we explain the relationship between y and the predictors? In unsupervised, so that's wrong, I should say unsupervised. In unsupervised learning, we will only have the predictors. And what we're trying to do is say, is there some relationship between these predictors? So the first one we're going to look at is principal component analysis, or PCA. So we've got p predictors, x1 up to xp. And if you think about it, you could, if you wanted to see the relationships between them, you could look at scatter plots. You could take two of these at a time and look at the scatter plots. But that gets really big, really, really quick. So for example, we know that if I want to choose two at the time, there would be p choose two pairwise scatter plots. So if I had 100 predictors, and we can get much more than this, we'd have 4,950 scatter plots. So it'd be really nice if we could actually sort of take all that relationships, all those variability in that, and reduce it down to maybe less possible comparisons we have to do. So PCA is really good at finding a low-dimensional representation that contains as much as possible of the variation. And these low-dimensional representations are called principal components. So how's it doing that? So what it does, we'll start with the first principal component. The first principal component is we're going to take a linear combination of the predictors. So we're going to take each predictor, multiply it by a constant, and then take the next predictor, multiply it by another constant, and add all those together. And we'll call that value we get Z1. And we want to choose those coefficients, the phi 1, 1, all the way up to phi p1, such that Z1 has the largest variance. Now, obviously, to make our variance really, really large, we could just blow out the phi. So we're going to also constrain that by saying it will be normalized, that is, that the sum of the square of the coefficients equals one. And those coefficients in PCA are called loadings. So you'll hear us talk about loadings and scores. So we're going to do this. Well, let's think about it. We're going to write in our vector notation that our linear combination we can denote as alpha 1 transpose x. Where X is our design matrix, we're going to take our alpha will contain all our loadings for the first principal component. And also we're going to denote the variance covariance of X as sigma. So we know from looking at the, you could do this by writing out a summation, but we're doing it in vector notation, but we know that the variance of alpha 1 transpose X is alpha 1 transpose sigma alpha 1. So that you should have seen in previous years, often SCHMEE. So what do you want to do? You want to choose the value of alpha 1, such that we will maximize the variance, which is this, such that we have that constraint, which can be written in vector form as alpha 1 transpose alpha 1 equals 1. Well, what we have here is we want to maximize an equation with a constraint. And the classic way we do that is Lagrange multipliers. So the Lagrange form of this is going to be our term we're interested in, our alpha 2, our heuristic, our alpha 1 transpose sigma alpha 1, minus we'll introduce the term lambda. And we want this constraint, which is alpha 1 transpose alpha minus 1. So this is our Lagrange multiplier. So we take this, we differentiate it with respect to alpha 1, we set to 0. And when we solve, we get this. Remember, this is a matrix, this is not a summation. So we get the variance covariance times alpha 1 equals some lambda times alpha 1. That is your standard indication that obviously alpha 1 is an eigenvector of our sigma, and lambda is the corresponding eigenvalue. So we know that the solution is going to be an eigenvalue eigenvector pair of sigma, but which one? Well, we want to maximize this. Well, we know the solution would be the form sigma alpha 1 equals lambda alpha 1, so we can substitute in. The lambda is just a scalar, so it can come out the front. And we know that this term is equal to 1. So we want to basically, if we want to maximize the variance, we want to find the maximal eigenvalue. So we do a decomposition. We find the maximum eigenvalue. That will be the choice that we should make. So we then find the corresponding eigenvector, and that is my loadings for the first principal component. What about the second principal component? What I want now is I want to choose a linear combination that I want to maximize its variance, but I want it such that my alpha 2, when I do my alpha 2x, this new thing will be uncorrelated, so have a zero covariance with my first principal. So I want my principal components to be uncorrelated. So I want it to be uncorrelated with my first principal component. Well, let's look at this. So I want the covariance of my first principal component, alpha 1 transpose x, and my second principal component, alpha 2 transpose x, to be equal to 0. Well, let's rearrange that. We can rearrange that, and this can be written as alpha 1 transpose sigma alpha 2. This is a scalar. So the transpose of a scalar is the same, so I can take the transpose, which gives me this. We know that we have our sigma alpha 1 is equivalent to lambda alpha 1, which we showed before. So that is now a scalar that comes out the front. So this can be written as lambda alpha 2 transpose alpha 1, and we'll come back to that. So now we're going to do our Lagrange. We have two constraints. I have, first of all, that we still want it to be normalized. So our alpha 2 transpose alpha 2 minus 1, that's our normalized. I also want this, the alpha 2 transpose alpha 1, to be equal to 0, because I want my covariance to be equal to 0, and this is what I'm trying to maximize. So I differentiate with respect to alpha 2, set to 0, I get this term. What we're going to do, first thing we're going to do is we're going to pre-multiply by alpha 1. So I've got these three terms. But notice, this first term is the covariance. We want it to be 0. This second term is the covariance. We want it to be equal to 0. So both these terms are going to be equal to 0. The only thing that's not equal to 0 is this. The second part, alpha 1 transpose alpha 1, is 1. So our phi, in this case, has to be equal to 0. It's the only way it can work. So we know that phi must equal 0. So the only solution to this would be another eigenvalue eigenpair. I'm not going to go, but basically, to get the next one, you go and choose the eigenvalue that's the next largest, so the second largest, and the eigenvector associated with that is what you want. And that's what we keep doing. You basically take all your eigenvalues, you rank them in decreasing order, you find the corresponding eigenvectors, and the first one will give you loadings for the first principal component, the second one, the second principal component, etc., etc. This is the most useful thing of eigenvalues, eigenvectors, that you were never told about in first year. Unless you did the course with Lewis, and Lewis would have told you all about it, because Lewis knows his stuff. So let's actually use it. So we're going to look at US arrest. So this is looking at states in America. It's from the 70s or 80s, I can't quite remember. And they've looked at things like the murder rate, the assault rate, the urban population, and the rape. And we're looking at the relationship between these. Before we do that, we're going to look at a thing called a parallel coordinate plot, which is a very nice thing. So what you do with a parallel coordinate plot is you take each individual subject. So in ours, each subject would be a state. In the penguins plot, each subject would be a penguin. And what you do is on the x-axis, you have all the variables you're interested in. So here in the penguin one, because we know it, you've got build depth, build length, body mass, flipper length. And then what you do is you draw a line for each penguin where you're joining the values. And this gives you an idea of the distribution and variability of these variables. So you can see, for example, in this case, there's a lot of variability in body mass, but you're not seeing it in the other ones. Also on this one, you can see that Gen 2 seems to have the largest body mass. Then you've got a lot of green lines for chin strap, and finally, the Adelie has very little. So it's a nice way of sort of seeing the relationships. Don't start looking for trends though. These are categorical variables. So they're just labels. So there isn't a natural order. I could change the order of this. It's more about how much variability we're doing. So let's go do this for the US data. And what you see here is you see that there's a lot of variability in assault, very little in murder, and then slightly less in rape than urban pop. The problem is, if I do my data like that, and this is what I'm showing the principal component, sorry, the parallel coordinates plot, most of the variability is in assault. It will automatically dominate anti-principal components. So one of the things we often do before we do our principal component is we normalize our data. So they're on a similar scale, and being on a similar scale, then we're not being dominated by the fact that assault in this case has huge amounts. So let's see how we do it. Well, we use recipes. So I'm going to set up a recipe. I'm saying we can use everything here. There's no outcome variable. It's unsupervised. I'm normalizing all the numerics, and then I do step PAC. And then I prep it, and it's good to go. If I use tidy, I can see, for example, you can see for principal component, the loading for murder is minus 0.536. Principal component one, the loading for assault is minus 0.583, etc. So this gives me all my loadings. You can visualize it. So you can see, for example, here in principal component, we've basically got a negative relationship between our principal component and these three things. You can see the most important one is assault, then rape, then murder, and finally urban population. PC2 seems to split it. You can see that urban pop is the most important type relationship in PC2, and it's a negative one, and then murder. Now, don't worry about the negative positive. It's not so much whether the negative or positive, because your vector could go either way. It's what's in that, what's most important within that predictor. So you can see here, this coordinate is all about urban population. This one is definitely all about rape. This is sort of a balancing act between murder and assault. So just a quick way of looking on it, what about the scores, which is actually what that the Z values would be that we saw right at the start. We can get them if you juice it. Here is for the first state, your value of PC1, PC2, PC3, PC4. You will have, if you have four predictors, you have four principal components. But you can often not use them all. You'll find that a lot of the variability will be explained in maybe the first two principal components. So that might be all you need. So you can actually do a dimension reduction with this. To show that it is just the eigenvalue decomposition, I've basically taken the correlation matrix of the USRS. Here is, in this particular case, my eigenvalues. And then when I looked at my steps and I had a look at my eigenvalues, I actually am looking at the variance terms. You can see they're exactly the same. If you look at the actual vectors, they should be, there we are. If we do the multiplication and look at our loading, these values here should be the same as those values there. So you see these give me my loadings that we saw at the start. These give me my variance terms for each of the principal components, and these, as we can see, match my eigenvalues. And finally, if I do the multiplication, these are my scores by doing a matrix multiplication, and these are the scores that I got from juice. So it's just doing an eigenvalue decomposition. So let's see how useful this can be. So what we've got here is we're going to look at breast cancer. So in this case, what they've done is they've taken samples of breast cancer from a hospital, and they've diagnosed them as being malignant or benign. So roughly, if you don't know, benign cancers are cells that will multiply and grow, but as they get bigger and bigger, they stay where they are. They don't spread elsewhere in the body. Malignant often spread. They get in the bloodstream, and then they can spread to places like the lungs and the liver. Benign is what you want. Benign, if it's in a really awkward area, it's hard to remove. Once you've removed it, you're pretty well good to go. Hopefully, if you've got a big enough margins, you're fine. While malignant, they've spread elsewhere, you need chemotherapy. So what we're doing here is we're looking at various samples, and we've got lots and lots of histological information. So they've looked at the cells under the microscope, and they're looking at shape and various information, and they're trying to use this to diagnose whether you're malignant or benign. The problem is there's lots and lots of different sorts of measures they have in this. And, you know, if we clean it up a little bit and have a look at a parallel coordinates plot, it's hard to see any obvious pattern. It's not as nice as we saw with the penguins. You can see that maybe these things are all a bit smaller when they're benign, a bit larger when they're malignant. It's hard to see. You can even do your scatter plots. And again, it's hard to easily see some patterns. There's obviously information there, but it's hard to see a definite pattern until we do a principal component. What I've done is I've done the principal component here, and I've just done a scatter plot of principal component 2 versus principal component 1. And you can see there's a really nice separation. So a linear combination of these variables separates it really well. It's a beautiful example of how there's information within that data that you can't see in the multidimensional. I mean, you reduce it down to take into account the principal components. Now patterns start to appear. And finally, my favorite version, this is a famous Nature paper. What they did is they took lots of samples of people's DNA. And you can do principal components on lots of things. In this case, they took each sample of DNA and they did a principal component analysis of their DNA. Then they just took all these people and they plotted them. They did PC1, PC2. And when they were looking at the plot, they suddenly realized there was something underneath it. And what you can see is, so these are just a scatter plot like before of our principal components of that genetic data. And what we're seeing is the map of Europe starting to appear. Here's Portugal, here's Spain. Then you come up, you've got France, you go up here to the UK, here's Ireland. It's a bit twisted and it's not quite, but you can see that the sort of location of where you're from is encoded in your DNA at a deep level. Okay, so that's principal components. And next time we'll start looking at some other unsupervised learning. Thank you very much.